We're going to talk a little bit, and I could go back and thank God for the teaching on Noah, and then we had a teaching on Samson, and then we had last Wednesday, is that right? Last Wednesday, and Sister Lois, she taught on who? Hagar. And since that's the freshest in our memory, we want to celebrate Hagar and what she has to say and how God used you, Sister Lois, to bring that to bear and to help us understand better. Tonight, I'm going to talk about a man that you're familiar with. As we continue with these character studies, and even though I'm inserted in this one, doesn't mean I'm going to be inserted to all of them, trust me. I think some of the participants have already become aware of the study time that it takes to present a character study and the enriching power of the word for our own lives as we study characters. I understand that the man of God spoke on Sunday. Yeah. Uh-huh. So that makes two speakers, three now. It'll be Bethany and Colin, and now another that we'll have to put out the church. Because I'm not having it. Just get out. You remember when Colin first spoke, Brother Andrea, he said that, he put me up here, might as well start changing the name on his office door. Yeah, and then somebody said, you can't go around just hanging on to rumors. But someone said that a certain person said they feel pretty comfortable up here. Now, I'm not one to go around spreading rumors, and I know you are not one to go around spreading rumors. So, of course, now that's not as bad as people who have the audacity to say that the pastor left meat on the bone. And it'll been a difference if she had a little height to her. But she just a short run. And so, all right. So, who am I going to talk about tonight? Drum roll, please. All right. I'm going to talk about Abram. Now, it's important for us to understand that while I might mention Abraham a little bit, but the first part one of this journey, and not knowing when part two will commence. But in part one, we're going to concentrate tonight on Abram, even though there's going to be some carryover. They're the same people, but just at different times of their life. And if you're anywhere close to over 40, then it was a time when you were 20. And the way you saw God and understood God at 20 changed by the time you kept walking with him and you became 40. You're the same person, but just different revelation and a different understanding. So with that being said, then, it is very, very important that you know that in your journey, that God is the same, you are the same person, but we can change as we move from faith to faith and to glory to glory. And that there are certain things that God says to you in different stages of your life to get you to his ultimate place and position. Okay? So that's just laying a little groundwork. So let's start off, if you would be so kind to go with me. I'm going to start in Genesis 11 first. 11 and 25. We'll begin there. And when you have Genesis 11 and 25, say, I have it. And Nabor lived after he begot Terah, and 119 years, and begot or had sons and daughters. And Terah lived 70 years and gave birth to Abraham, Nahor, and Haran. Now, these are the generations of Terah. Terah begot or gave birth to Abraham, Nahor, and Haran, and Haran begot Lot. So automatically, Haran is what relation to Abram? Say it again. Okay, 26 again. And Terah lived 70 years and begot Abram, Haran, Nahor, and Haran. So now, once again, the question is, what relation now is Haran with Abraham? Brothers. And Haran begot who? Lot, which makes Lot Abram's, very good class, nephew. And Haran died, sad to say, before his father, Terah, in the land of his nativity, in Ur of the Chaldees. And Abram and Nahor, now the land of their captivity was Ur of the Chaldees, and that's where Haran had died, which is the land of his nativity. And since he's Abram's brother, what is Abram's land of nativity? Ur of the Chaldees, very good. And Abram and Nahor took them wives. It's sad that you got to take them. I'm not giving you no vows. I saw you and I just swooped you up. And so she's just, wait a minute, where are we going? I'm taking you. And Abram and Nahor, and see, that wouldn't work today. Because sisters carry tasers. And Abram and Nahor took them wives, and the name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah, and the daughter of Haran. How about that? The father of Milcah and the father of Iscah. But Sarah was barren, and she had no child. And Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, or Haran, his son's son, and Sarai, his daughter-in-law, his son Abram's wife, and they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees to go into the land of Canaan. And they came unto Haran and dwelt there. And the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. All right, so let's just stop back a little bit and give me, I don't know if I gave this to you, but give me Joshua 24 and 2. Joshua 24 and 2. I just want to talk a little bit about Terah. Who is Terah? It sounds like blah, 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 blah. So thank you so much for such clarity. Anytime the saints get a whiff of diesel, they just don't talk that loud. Joshua 2, and Joshua said to all the people, thus says the Lord God of Israel, your fathers, including who? Whatever fits your fancy. Your fathers, including Terah, the father of Abraham and the father of Nahor, dwelt on the other side of the river in old times, and they served other gods. So that tells us that Abraham's daddy served other gods. Now, again, I told you there may be a little overlap, but I won't go into Abraham too much. But we had picked up from last week that Abraham had given up his wife to the Pharaoh in Egypt. And that had to have been horrible. And he said, tell them you're my sister. Well, technically, she was his half-sister. Half. And not 100%, but half. So just remember that. And so anyway, that's what I want you to see about Terah. Now, if you'll be so kind, then go with me to Genesis chapter 12. Now the Lord, and key word, had said to Abram. When did he say it? He had said it, which means he said it before this event. Because remember, in 11, it says that Terah got all his family together and he went over to Haran. You see? But the call of Abraham had took place sometime in that time frame. And now the idol worshiper. Now, some history says that he made idols, but we have no biblical reference to that, that authenticates the fact that he made idols in an idol workshop in Abraham. So there are a whole lot of stories out there. One being Abraham had to keep the store. Think about that. And while his father, Terah, went away and somebody came in to buy a little idol, and then Abraham asked him, according to the story, Abraham asked him, how old are you? The guy said, 50. He said, how in the world are you being 50? You're going to worship something that just was made today. Think about that. Now, that's a story, and can that be verified? It cannot. So, now the Lord had said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. And I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing. And I will bless those that bless you. And I'll curse those who curse you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken to him. And Lot went with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Then Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people whom they had acquired in Haran, and they departed to go to the land of Canaan. So they came to the land of Canaan. I want to stop right there. So let's do some map time so we can kind of get a little picture of his journey. And I may have to turn a little bit. So here is what? You can see it? Good for you. This is Ur of the what? Of the Chaldeans. I knew you were related to them. Okay, and so here's his journey right on up this line. It's a nice little stretch. And he's going to come right up here to where? Haran. And so this is right there on the border of Mesopotamia. And so then from Haran, he comes down here and he goes over here. And he comes down through. He's headed to the land of through the land of Canaan, okay? And so what a wonderful journey. But now he continues, and he eventually gets to Shechem. Well, he goes through here and ends up over here in Egypt. That's where he ends up. It's down here, but this whole area here in Egypt. All right, that's where he gives away his wife. Remember that? All right. And then he comes right back and he ends up in Shechem or in the land of Canaan. Canaan would incorporate at that time Israel and a lot more territory, even territory that has not been acquired yet. But because God's promise is what his promise is, no matter that he promised it 4,000 years ago, the land of Israel is bigger than what the territory boundaries are now. And they will be bigger. They've never been as big as they will be because God's promises don't fail, even though there's time gaps in between it. How many understand that? All right. Now, let me give you that territorial look from a today's map. And we will see that Ur is in the land of current Same land, because earth hasn't changed. It's the same earth. So here he is. He goes from right here in Iraq, and he's going to come right there north of Syria, and he's going to go to Haran, then come through Canaan, which and Israel, and then he's going to go over here, and then his people are going to be in bondage in Egypt. And God said they're going to come back to Jerusalem because Abraham came back to Jerusalem also, and God gave a promise. Okay, so that's to give you a now time picture of his journey, because he went out looking for a city whose builder and maker was God. But that city he was looking for on the earth was in heaven, right? So the scripture in Hebrews said he looked for a city. And in the same passages, he said he also looked for a country. And so therefore, it's appropriate for me to call the New Jerusalem that is dwelling in heaven right now a country. Or if there's a country, then I can call heaven the planet heaven without insulting you. In other words, it has locations. It has a city. It has Beulah land. It has a capital city. And all of the cities are much, much, much larger. So we don't know how large heaven is. We know how large a city in heaven is, one of its cities. Okay, any questions so far? Yes, miss. And yes. Yeah, this miss. Yeah, I'll give that to you. Because, see, I didn't look it up. I just knew it from history, that way I researched it, that she technically was his half-sister, and then I'll get the scripture to back that up. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Yes?
Can you estimate how many miles the trip would have been, and perhaps how long it took him, this journey?
I can't, but someone in the audience with a phone can. So who wants that assignment right now in real time, lest we perish? Who can do that for me? No one has a phone in church. I understand that you are sanctified. Yeah, Scotty, can you look that up for me? Scotty is getting it, and Scotty is the man. Yeah, Scotty's going to make that happen. Okay? So while he's getting that, any other questions about this journey? And it's going to be kind of probably difficult unless he can really get the route, because he goes here to here, and then down here, and then over here, and then back up here. So, I mean, that's big country there. And that's a lot of traveling. And there was no trains. Where is Sodom and Gomorrah? Sodom and Gomorrah will be, which I have seen the land of Sodom and Gomorrah, off from, it's here in this area, but off over in here, if I'm thinking right. But they are good questions, okay? Where's Sodom and Gomorrah? Yeah, that's another one we just put down, and we get some specifics for you on that. Okay.
You want it now?
Yeah, go ahead.
One thousand five hundred fifty-one miles,
and from here to Florida is about what, 900 miles, depending on which part of Florida you get to. That's a long walk. No one, it says they sojourned. Yeah, and wow, and then 1,500 miles at least. That's called dedication. So anybody who just feel like the church is too far away, but the will of God is never too far away. Am I right? Praise God. Okay. So Canaan encompasses present-day Israel and then much, much more. This here is the Sinai Peninsula, which, you know, this is Mount Sinai here. And what happened at Mount Sinai? Yeah, Moses received the law and the Ten Commandments, and a dynamic a force of angels were involved in this to deliver that covenant. And the scriptures bear witness to that. And maybe we're going to talk about that in just a moment over in Acts chapter 7. All right. So let's move on. And now I'm going to encourage you to go back and read these scriptures. And so I've read Genesis 12. And now I am going to go over to Genesis 13 in this journey. And in Genesis 13, let me have the eighth verse, if you can. Now, Abram is coming out of Egypt, and he survived giving his wife away and getting her back, but he came out very rich. How rich? Very rich. Much gold, much silver, much cattle. He really came out very rich. And so now, by the time we get to the fifth verse, speaking of their flocks and their herds and their tents and all of that, it says in the sixth verse, am I right at the sixth verse? 13 and 6. Okay. Now the land was not able to support them, and they might, that they might dwell together, for their possessions were so great that they could not dwell together. And there was a strife between the herdsmen and Abram's livestock and the herdsmen of Lot's livestock. The Canaanites and the Perizzites then dwelt in the land also, I would add also. So Abram said to Lot, please let there be no strife between you and me and between my herdsmen and your herdsmen, for we are brethren. Isn't that beautiful? Is not the whole land before you? Please separate from me. And if you take the left, then I'll go to the right. Or if you go to the right, then I'll go to the left. And Lot lifted up his eyes and saw all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, by the way. Like the, now that's why when I said over here, because Jordan is over here. When you hear on the news talking about the West Bank, it's the West Bank of Jordan, okay? And over in this area, that'll be the West Bank of Jordan. But over here, you see in the scripture, he is turned towards Jordan, and it was well watered and all that. And Egypt was, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt as you go towards Zoar. Let's go a little further. Then Lot chose for himself all the plain of Jordan, and Lot journeyed east, and they separated from each other. Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan, and Lot dwelt in the cities of the plain and pitched his tent even as far as Sodom. But the men of Sodom were exceedingly wicked and sinful against the Lord. And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated, this is what I want you to hear. After Lot had separated from him, lift up your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I give to you and your descendants forever. Now I want you, and I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. That is pretty powerful, isn't it? All right. So now I want to let you know that God is making these promises and covenants while Abram is Abram and not Abraham. He's still Abram. Now, when he becomes Abraham, he's still Abram, but change has come and he becomes Abraham. But right now, I just want to show you the dealings of God while he was Abram. This is his early journey. Everybody got an early journey, right? And as you grew and God revealed himself to you, you believed and you trusted him. So now to continue on with the journey, in chapter 14, we're going to get into that conflict. Matter of fact, that's where he goes down and he rescues Lot. So that's what's going to happen in chapter 14. And the king of Sodom tries to negotiate to keep the people and give Abraham the good. And Abraham said, look, I lifted my hand from the Lord, and I'm not going to take not a string from you, lest you say that you made Abram rich, that you are the cause of making Abram. You will not get that credit, and plus we're going to keep all the people too, including my nephew. Okay, so now from there, we're going to go over to chapter 15. All right. So chapter 15, verse 1. All right. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram. Who? Abram, in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceeding great reward. But Abram said, Lord God, what will you give me, seeing I go childless, and the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus? Then Abram said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, saying, this one shall not be your heir, but one who will come from your own body shall be your heir. Then he brought him outside and said, look now towards heaven and count the stars, if you are able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. Pretty powerful, isn't it? Sixth verse is what's important. And he believed God, and God, he counted it to him for righteousness. Then he said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldees to give you this land to inherit it. Now, he is making covenant with Abram. Now, in our times, in most times, a country is defined by territorial boundaries. It is a group, a people group that can have different traditions and cultures and different things like that. But typically, they are defined by distinct boundaries and by some governmental or rulership system, okay? And that makes a people group country, and that would apply in our day. It applied back then also. Even though the earth is the Lord's, there are territorial boundaries established by men that say this is our country and not yours, okay? However, when it comes to the kingdom of God, everyone say kingdom. It is a people group who call on the name of Jesus, who are not defined by earthly government, but they are formed and defined by covenants. So the kingdom of God is a country that Abraham was looking for, whose government is in our heart. And the territory is the whole world, because he told you to go into all the world and preach the gospel. So when it comes to the kingdom, the things that define us as a country of people. You want Bible to back that up? Well, you are a royal priesthood, a chosen generation, a holy nation, that we should show forth the praises of him that brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light. So, but what is our nation ruled by? It's ruled by covenants. And the covenant that we enjoy right now is the new covenant where Jesus Christ is the head of the country, which encompasses the whole earth, because the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And you might need a passport to go to France because they're territorial boundaries. But you can pray for somebody in France and you already have a passport to do it. Okay? Now, I'm not telling you to jump on a plane and go to France without your documents. I'm not telling you that one. And neither am I saying that territory boundaries are not, you know, okay. But please know that the earth is the Lord's. And from our Constitution, which is the Bible and the New Covenant expressly, that is out of that covenant that we are formed as one nation. How many got that? So that no matter where our people are in France, Iraq, Iran, Australia, England, Kenya, Ethiopia, Israel, wherever the Lord's people are, we are one nation. We are chosen generation. And I may say again, we are chosen not because we were chosen to accept Christ. We were chosen because we accepted Christ. Remember, you're not chosen to drink the water. After you drink the water, you're chosen. So therefore, Christ is the center of it all. And no man comes to the Father except by me. Everybody understand that? Okay, so now we're moving on down here and a little further. We're going to slip over here now to the 17th chapter. And this is where it gets real, real significant and real good. 17th chapter is the transition chapter. And I think I want to start at the, let me see here. I think I'm going to start at 17 and 1. When Abram was 99 years old, and somebody would say that's old. But Abram was 75 when God called him, 86 when Ishmael was born, 99 when he was circumcised, and 100 when Isaac was born. Man got a lot of stuff going on in his life, isn't he? When Abram now was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am Almighty God. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my what? I'm going to make my covenant between me and you and will multiply you exceedingly. Then Abram fell on his face and God talked with him saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you and you shall be a father of many nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be called Abraham. Abraham meaning the father of many nations. Abram meaning the high father. Really, Abram means the high father, transitioning to the father of many nations. And he's telling him all of this before he had one child. He didn't have no children at all. And yet God was speaking into his future. And all the situations seemed too bleak for that promise to be possible. Because my wife is old and I'm old, and what is naturally being experienced by my oldness and the promises coming from the fresh winds of God. This is second wind time, y'all. God's trying to breathe on him and tell him it's second wind time, man. And it's not up to you to determine the signs and the seasons and the times. It's up to me. And even though you're 99 years old, listen, you're going to still have what I told you you're going to have. Because God's promises don't fail. And even in our covenant, every promise of God is what? Yes and what? Amen. Yes and amen. And we should continue to be the people to understand that God's covenant is with us. not through the blood of animals and goats and heifers and the sprinkling of ashes, but through the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, who paid the ultimate price so that all men can be saved who would come to him by faith. And so even when a man comes to the Lord by faith, it's not on the man alone. It's not left up to you. No man can come to the Father unless the Spirit of God is drawing him. Nobody just can't wake up and say, you know, I think I'll turn to Jesus, without some tangible in your heart interaction of God dealing with you. Because even in the old covenant, God dealt with them. Except when he showed up with Moses, he was a fire in a bush. Think that that's not tangible? Okay, how about let's go a little further. Moses said, I'm going to go check this thing out because I'm seeing a bush on fire, but it's not being consumed. So he could still see the branches just with their hands lifted, but it's on fire. Soon as that, it should have broke down and fell to the ground, but it was being sustained by the power that was lifting it up. That's a good preach, but it's for another day. By the way, Moses gets up there, and the first thing the Lord speaks out of that bush and said, take your shoes off. Why do you want me to take my shoes off? Because the ground that you're standing on is holy ground. What made the ground holy? You could say God did. But the truth of the matter is that God was in the bush, and the bush was stuck in the ground. And anything God is in, he's going to sanctify anything that God is in. So the roots were sanctified, and everything that the roots were in was sanctified. And so therefore, I don't want anything to come between me and you. So get your shoes off, boy. And when he took his shoes off, do you think he just said, this is just dirt? No, God was in that ground. And you think that was a tangible experience? A tingle? Please. A bush is burning and not being consumed. What in the world happens when my feet touch the ground that the bush is in? That's something to think about. What I'm saying is that God is a God that you can feel. Some people say, you know, I don't believe in, you know, religion that's too emotional. Well, guess what? You cannot be unemotional and be rescued from drowning. You can't be unemotional and don't have a thank you, Jesus, on your lips if you are rescued, if you are lifted up, if you are saved, if you are delivered. You can't even get married to the love of your life without having some emotions. Because if you just like, when you this day, here I am, take Lula Bell to be your lawful and wedded wife. Yes. Say it again. Yeah, because if you're going to be that unemotional, that's an indication. But you know that's not true. It's when you make a vow and a covenant in marriage, it's happy time. It's happy time. It's joyful time. All right. And so therefore, when Jesus saved me, I was broken first, but my tears turned to joy. You see, I didn't come to Jesus happy. Because happy don't cause you to repent. Did you hear that? What did I say? Happy don't cause you to repent. Godly sorrow works repentance. And that takes place when God lets you feel for the first time how he feels about your sin. It's individual, it's personal. And so that produces godly sorrow, which causes you to change your mind. Amen? And so now we, as we consider this journey from Abram to Abraham, we see that God paved the way and helped him out with covenant after covenant after covenant, telling him what he was going to do. This is going to be given to your descendants. This is going to be for your descendants. And he said, but I don't have no kids, and I'm old. Then finally he breaks down and said, God, what are you going to give me seeing that I don't have no descendants? He said, well, I tell you what, you're going to have a child, and that child's going to come from Sarah's womb. Abram laughed first, and Sarah laughed later. Now, let me take you to another little nugget now. And you just kind of have to follow along with me a little bit. And let's go to Genesis chapter 14 and the 13th verse. Genesis 14 and 13. Then one who had escaped came and told Abram the first time Hebrew is mentioned in the scripture. Abram the what? Abram the what again? Abram the Hebrew. For he dwelt by the terebinth trees of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eshcol, and the brother of Aner, and they were allies with Abram. I just want you to remember that. Let's go down to another one. And let's go down to Genesis 39 and 14. And this is going to speak of Joseph. And this is Potiphar's wife who had this feeling to become a hoochie and go after the man of God with the sciences of hoochieism. And then she says that she called the men of the house and spoke to them, saying, "See, he brought into us a Hebrew," talking about Potiphar, "to mock us. He came into me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice." Now, how many of you know that she is lying? Because Joseph didn't do that. It's going to land him in jail. But guess what? God was with him. But please note that she said he brought in that Hebrew. Okay? Then why would you have them lusting eyes for him then? He wasn't that Hebrew while you were lusting. All right, we'll go a little bit further. And let's go to 41 and 12. Speaking of Joseph still. You got it? Yep. Now there was a young Hebrew man with us there, a servant of the captain of the guard, and we told him, and he interpreted our dreams for us. To each man, he interpreted according to his own dream. Isn't that powerful? All right. Then in Exodus 1:16, 1:19. Let's do it 1:16 just to make it wonderful. Can you do that? 1:16. And he said, speaking of Pharaoh, "When you do the duties of a midwife for the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stools, if it be a son, then you shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live." But the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the male children alive. So the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said to them, "Why have you done this thing and saved the male children alive?" And the midwives said to Pharaoh, "Because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women. For they are lively and give birth before the midwives come into them." Now, the midwives said the Hebrew women are not like us. The word Hebrew means from the other side. So now Abram is the first Hebrew mentioned. Now it can relate to the River of Jordan, but in context with that word, it means from the other side. And we, as Abraham's seed, which, by the way, that would make me Hebrew too. Am I right? Yeah. Yeah. Because if anybody has faith in Jesus Christ, then we are Abraham's seed. That's all I'm saying. With no territorial boundaries, we're bound together by covenant. That is so good. Preach it again, Pastor. We have no territorial lines. We're bound together by covenant. We have no territorial lines. We're bound together by covenant. The body of Christ is bound together by covenant. And within the covenant comes the promises of God. We're bound together because we are one body and we are one holy nation, not one many. We are made of many nations, but we become one nation in Christ, bound together by covenant, established and formed by covenant. And so now the word Hebrew, as I said, speaks to from the other side. So therefore, when Abram rolls in with this confidence that he's not like everywhere else he's journeying, because he's from the other side. And so when Joseph is put in prison, the fact that God was with him and he was not like the Egyptians, neither did he serve the Egyptian, is because he was from the other side. And so if you get Daniel and the three Hebrew boys who weren't afraid of the flames of fire, why? Because they're from the other side. And when it comes to you and me, we are not of this world. We're from the other side. And the other side is where the covenants are established. The other side is where burning bushes flame, but they're not burned down. We're from those who will take our shoes off to stand where God is so that we can have a direct connection with the living God. And we are purchased people. We are different from the world. So therefore, we don't love the world and we're not of the world. The capital city where our names are written is New Jerusalem, because we're from the other side. And you should have this in your consciousness, that you're not to be of this world. Neither should you love the world. Any man who loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And we are Abraham's seed. And since he was from the other side, no matter the fact that Terah, his daddy, worshiped other gods, Abraham believed in one God. And it could have been that the daddy eventually caught on to the faith of his son and moved his family, at least to Haran, headed to Canaan. That Abram was steadfast before the sign of the covenant, before the law. And that's why in the new covenant it says, did Abraham receive promise under the law? He did not. He didn't receive the covenant of the promise under Abraham. It was while he was uncircumcised, because Abram believed God and it was counted as righteousness. And the thing that makes us righteous is the fact that we believe God. And we got two thieves on the cross. You got one barking at Jesus, trying to give him orders of what to do to get off the cross and live a little bit longer. And then you got the other one from the other side saying, Lord, when you enter into your kingdom, and I know you have one, just remember me. The Lord speaks to the other side and says, this day you will be with me in paradise. What the Lord is saying to us through this journey about Abram in the early years, even though it's been 100 years plus, but in the early years, is that if you stay with me, I won't fail you. It doesn't mean that he was perfect. It just means he was serving a perfect God. And in when he made blunders, the living God, because of his covenant with him. And even when Israel got real foolish, even Moses said, don't you remember what you told Abraham? Because God said, move back, Moses, I'm going to destroy them all. He said, oh, don't burn them up. What are the other nations going to say? You brought them out, you couldn't keep them? So the Lord relented. He just got them, 40 years later as their carcasses fell in the wilderness. So what could have been instantaneous? 40 years, doesn't matter. Those who entered in are those who believed. The reason they were cut off, because of unbelief. The word of the Lord to us in these joyful and dire times. Joyful? Why joyful? Because soon and very soon, we're going to see a king. Amen. Joyful because we set our affections above and not beneath. If anybody got their affection beneath, you're in trouble. But if we set our affection above where Christ sits, there's freedom, there's joy. It's not a time where God's people should say, this is a good time not to walk in the joy of the Lord, because Jesus gave us his joy. It's not even ours, it's his. And then we recognize the times in which we live in. Dire times. Sodom and Gomorrah was a horrible time to live in if you were down there in Sodom. Now, I just want to tell this without being too graphic. I'm not going to be too graphic. Everybody say not too graphic. But you better read between these lines. Don't think that the Sodomites were slipping off under the tent. It had become so deprived, as one said, that it was just open. You going downtown and you're trying to get into Sweet Aromas, and you don't think the depravity of man can reach down there? Oh, please, before this wraps up, it's going to be illegal to say anything to him for it. Because you couldn't say anything then. You got that picture, didn't you? I'm not being graphic, but just think it's just open. So we start out and say, you know, okay, now here in Belfound, the fateful city, we can have open containers downtown. Now, it didn't used to be that way. Am I right about it? Then all of a sudden, just casual is introduced. Casual, and everybody says, oh, it's open container. We're just like other cities. But we are not other people. We're from the other side. I want you to understand this. That, listen, when Jesus said, and you shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake, it's high time that we are. And everybody don't want to run into that line. They don't want to get into that line. But you don't have to get in that line. You don't have to just I'm going to push you in that line. No. Just be the light that shines on darkness and see how you'll be treated. Because there is a part of the world that are digging their heels in. And then there are those who are yet to be saved. And God is going to pour out his spirit upon all flesh. And God's still going to make his promises good. And there's still yet a remnant to be saved. And there are going to be some people yet saved. But there are going to be some people that are going to dig in. They're going to dig in. And the governments will change. And things will change. And times and seasons and decrees will be changed in these last of the last days. Do you not know that I've said this before, and you just judge whether or not you think I've heard from the Lord, that the Antichrist is not ordered into position by God. The Antichrist is called in position by the people. Because the heart of the people have to be prepared to receive something that's anti-God, and the man will step forward because my hour has come. Paul said, now I told you before that the Antichrist will come and that there are many Antichrists. God hadn't ordered anybody to be Antichrist. He wanted to save the world through Christ. So the head of the Antichrist is the devil, according to the scripture. But he couldn't force his way in. Let me give you Bible to back up what I'm saying, because that's the kind of people you are. And the Bible says, and the whole world wondered after him and said, who is able to make war with him? For his chief prophet calls down fire from heaven. Whew. Just lightning. That's the season that's incorporated with the time of the Gentiles that's going to come to a close. But we are those from the other side. That's right. From the other side. From the other side, we dwelt in tents. From the other side, we had a tabernacle. And it was covered in badger skin. And one writer said, you can imagine that the enemies that looked on that tent in the wilderness says, surely God can't be in that. Isn't it just like the world to look at you and say, surely God, after all we knew that you used to do, surely God is not with you now. God can't dwell in you. Oh, yes, he don't dwell in tabernacles made with hands. He dwells in the hearts of men now, because there's a new covenant in town. And because there's a new covenant, there's a new sheriff in town. And there's a people in town. that we don't have to force our way, beat our way, but we can walk in the certainty of his promises and to participate in a generation that's participating in the last of the last days so that we won't be soon shaken by anything. In other words, we can look at how deplorable men can behave, but we can always have a check in our mind. We're going to save some. But this is what was prophesied, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. Men will be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure, more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, a form of it, but denying the power thereof. More than love of pleasure? More than lovers of God? So why would you add more than lovers of God? Because they would say that, well, I love God. I just love pleasure more. Isn't that in line with the scripture? I just love pleasure more. And every man has to check themselves. Everyone has to work out their own soul salvation. You don't need to beat down. You just need to awaken to the Spirit of God that's putting on the alarm inside of us that it's high time for victory time. It's victory time. It's victory time. And you got to have a victory mindset to wage your way through this world system and not be pulled off and pulled aside or to stand in fear of any kind, because your God is the God of covenant and he's binding his whole people together around the world through covenant. And all of us are from the other side. We're not of this world. You got to know that. We're not of this world. And so only the people of God make the land better. Because when the people of God rule, then the land is at peace, according to the scripture. And what is that land? Where is that land? That's whatever the environment that you're in. So how the, you know, Abraham thought would think that he's supposed to rule. And not rule dominating anything, but let your light shine that men should may see your good works and glorify God that is in heaven. That's what I'm talking about. And so is our call in God to be and to walk as his people. Again, bound together by covenants. And he took the bread and he broke it. He said, this is my body that's broken for you. Eat all of it. Covenant time. And he took the cup. This is the cup of the new covenant. As often as you do it, remember me. But this covenant is a covenant in the blood of Jesus, which is the most awesome force on the planet. So give me Acts chapter 7, and we're going to wrap this up, okay? Let's hear Stephen's defense in Acts chapter 7 as he summarizes what I have to say. Now, he is going to use Abraham, but we know in part of this he's talking about Acts chapter 7, and I think I want the second verse. So this begins with him saying, they are charging him that, you know, he's trying to change laws and things are getting real bad, and he's speaking and preaching blasphemies and all that. Then the high priest said, are these things so? First verse, second verse, and he said, brethren and fathers, listen. The glory of God appeared to our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia. We know that was Abram, right? Before he dwelt in Haran, and said to him, get out of your country and from your relatives and come to a land that I will show you. Then he came out of the land of the Chaldeans and dwelt in Haran. And from there, when his father was dead, he moved him to this land in which you now dwell, speaking of Israel. And God gave to him no inheritance in it, not even enough to set his foot on. But even when Abraham had no child, he promised to give it to him for possession and to his descendants after him. When God made the promise, he didn't see the end of the promise. But God spoke in this way, that his descendants would dwell in a foreign land and that they would bring them into bondage and oppress them 400 years. And the nation to whom they will be in bondage, I will judge, said God. And after that, they shall come out and serve me in this very place. Then he gave him the covenant of circumcision. And so Abraham begot Isaac and circumcised him on the eighth day. And Isaac begot Jacob, and Jacob begot the 12 patriarchs. Then he goes on to talk about the patriarchs in in Egypt, and how Moses comes in the 17th verse. Moses comes to deliver them. And so I just want to get down to the fact that then the 51st verse, if you would. And this is, James is on a roll now. Stephen. 51, and this is a tough preach. You stiff neck and uncircumcised in heart and ears. You always resist the Holy Spirit as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets did your fathers not persecute? And they killed those who foretold the coming of the just one, of whom you are now have become the betrayers and murderers, who have received the law by the direction of angels and have kept it. And when they heard these things, they were cut to their heart and they gnashed at him with their teeth. But he being full of the Holy Spirit, gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God and said, look, I see the heavens open to the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. Then they cried out with a loud voice, stopped their ears, ran at him with one accord, and they cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their garments at the feet of one called Saul. Here's something dynamic. The heavens open. He sees the Father and the Son because the Spirit of God was in him, allowing him to see the other two. It's a picture of really the Trinity. Trinity doesn't appear in the Bible, but you see the Holy Spirit discloses the Father and the Son. And so he could see Jesus standing beside his Father while the Holy Spirit inside of him was making it all real. A dynamic picture, and then he fell asleep. They stoned him, and he fell asleep. So they stoned him. He said, don't lay this sin to their charge, which I say was enough to cause Jesus to stand up, because it sounded like him, didn't it? And as they stoned him, he just fell asleep. Night, night, y'all. See ya. I'm not going to give you the pleasure to kill me. I'm just going to take a nap. But when I wake up, I'll be in the face of Jesus. Amen. What a covenant. Questions? Yes.
Do we know how old Abraham was when he died?
We do. That's scriptural. We can find that out. Now, do I know it off the top of my head? Scotland, into your ministry, brother. Yeah. I don't want to guess it, but he started a little late with that children thing. Well, he'll give it to you in just a minute. Yeah, and this can be backed up by the years in the scripture as to when he actually passed away. Oh, 2,000 on the miles.
Yeah.
Okay, did you get the age of Abraham when he died? 175 years old. Pretty young, wasn't it? Compared to Methuselah. Yeah. So in other words, you just got hope. I understand. Yeah. Be it unto you. Yeah. Yes. It was salvation by faith. it was that's what makes him the father of our faith, because Abraham believed God, so that now we can believe God that Christ's death was applied to us. And he did the work, and all we have to do is believe and obey him. And that is applied to our life. Not just believe, because that's counting short. Believe and organically obey him, because we are a new creation. We got a new heart. We got a new person. Shall we sin that grace may abound? God forbid. That doesn't even make sense, that you now are a new creation in Christ Jesus, and old things have passed away, and you want to come from the other side where the covenant is and come up and run with the Taliban. That don't make sense. So 175 years old, okay? And you said the journey is more like 1,500 to 2,000 years?
Well, 1,500 was like straight lines on the map.
Okay. That's a long way to journey. That'll take a lot of your life. But the journey is worth it all. Amen? Yes. That's right. Yeah. Abraham is their father. And they claim Abraham as their father. Islam does that. But the believing Arab, and when I was in Israel, Palestinians were working in the marketplace. They were serving in the military. So it's not like with all the television tells you, because they, you know, got to give ratings. But these people, they love peace. They love Israel and all those things. They don't have no problem. I went over into Gaza, and I went to a Palestinian bookstore, Christian bookstore. And that's where a lady kind of came up to me and said, "Do you believe in Yeshua?" No, she asked me if I was Christian. She said, "Are you Christian?" I said, "I am." She said, "I believe in Yeshua." I said, "Ooh." And then she said, "Let me show you," because I was holding one of those prayer shawls. She said, "Let me show you. Let me show you." And so she put it over my head, and she had folded it just a right way and put it around my shoulders, because she was making a tabernacle. That's what that tent, it represented a tent where you would tabernacle with God. And so they call it a prayer shawl, but it's the tent of meeting. Anywhere in your house that represented that you could call on the name of the Lord. For this is the Holy of Holies now. And you have access to God with a new covenant. You can come boldly to the throne of God. That you have access to the throne of God, that you may find help in the time of need. That's the covenant we live after. And when it comes to God's promise about Ishmael being a great nation, it's not great numerically. The fullness is not done yet. God is going to bring all things to pass that he said. And he said, "I'm going to bless Ishmael." So if he's going to bless Ishmael, he's not going to bless them to be without faith in him. He is going to pour out his spirit, guess what, on all flesh. And everybody who used to be Hindu, that used to be Muslim, that used to be lukewarm church-going people from Laodicea. In these hours right now, the Lord is pouring out his spirit upon all flesh. This is the great harvest time, and there'll be other harvest time, but we're right in the middle of it right now. Okay? All right. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Well, according to the scripture, it's going to go all the way out there to the Tigris and Euphrates, all up in this area. And then so that will take in all this part of Syria. And then you got Lebanon and all of that that's coming down there. and all that Gaza Strip stuff, and that'll be all theirs too. And the King of Kings is going to set his throne up in Jerusalem. And he's going to go through that sealed up golden gate that they said, we don't believe, but, you know, we're just going to block it up anyway. As if that block is going to be able to stop Jesus. If a shofar would bring down the walls of Jericho, what happens when the King of Kings? Yeah. And it's not too hard for him, because when he puts his feet on the Mount of Olives, it's going to split in half. And then he's going to make his journey into Jerusalem. I'll be with him. You'll see me and I'm going to say, told you. Told you. Isn't that going to be a great day that we'll be looking at this? The pastor was right. Pastor was right. The king has come to Jerusalem. And we are his court, kings and priests unto our God. Worthy is the Lamb. No wonder we cast our crowns at his feet. Yes. Okay. And he's moving with a herd and great riches and animals and all of that. So it pretty much took a chunk out of your life. The journey here takes a chunk out of our life, but in comparison to everlasting life, it's a vapor. Right? According to the scripture. So anybody who say, well, that's too hard. Nothing too hard, because there's nothing too hard for God. I want you to have confidence. God wants you to have confidence that he is the same God of the Bible that lives in you. Amen? Amen. Yes?
Abraham and Sarah's brother-sister references in Genesis 20:12.
Can you get that on screen for me? Genesis 20:12. Abraham married his sister. And Micah has found it. Genesis 20:12, if you could pull that up, please. And let's look at it together. But indeed, she is truly my sister. She is the daughter of my father. And my father's name is
Terah,
but not the daughter of my mother. And she became my wife. However, the motive of his heart in saying, tell them you're my sister, was to save his own neck. So, but God took care of him, didn't he? Pharaoh, you know, brought him into his harem and all of that. And God comes to him and say, you're dead, man. I'm going to kill you and everything, everybody, your dog, your cat, everybody. Yes. Do we know where the Garden of Eden is? I can't exactly pinpoint it. I really can't. But someone once said that likewise is somewhere on the border of Iraq and somewhere where you have to have the Tigris and the Euphrates. Yeah, because it was so lush, so beautiful.
I just wondered if they had seen it.
Oh, no. Mm-mm. No, they wouldn't have seen the Garden of Eden. So, right here in Jerusalem, I just remember being up somewhere in this area, and they said, look off over there, that's Sodom and Gomorrah. But wherever the Dead Sea is, let's see, this is the Sea of Galilee. No, this is the Sea of Galilee. This is the Dead Sea. Sodom and Gomorrah was off over in here. Because this is the salt sea. And they used that, say, you know, she turned to a pillar of salt and polluted the water. Nothing lives in the Dead Sea. Nothing. It is so salty, it just will burn your eyeballs out.
I've been there, done that. Yeah, but I saw it from a distance, you know, because the God said over there. And so with that being said, I'm going to ask you a question, but we're going to close out now. Everybody just thank God. But Lord, we thank you so much for today. Thank you for your word and for life. In Jesus' name, amen.